Hello and welcome to the first episode of the Film Historians Interview Series, where we're going to take a look and talk to individuals who are intertwined with the rich history of film. On today's episode, I'm talking to Nathan Butler, author of A Saga on Home Video, a fan's guide to U.S. Star Wars home video releases. Welcome to the show, Nathan. Thanks for being our first guest.
Oh, thanks for having me. It's an honor. First guest. That's fantastic.
I know. I started the channel a couple weeks ago. Tossed up a couple videos, talked about how The Shining and Star Wars are connected through behind the scenes, the fire at Elstree Studios, talked about Taxi Driver and Martin Scorsese, but I figured to split up the video process that I'll go ahead and put an interview with some people that I'd really like to talk to so we can give, you know, viewers a chance to, you know, take a look at film history from a different perspective. So I'm going to talk to you. If we introduce the discussion, like I already stated, Nathan's book documents the history of Star Wars on home video. I've always considered myself to be an expert on the subject, but to be completely honest, this book made me feel like an amateur. So in this discussion, I'd like to ask you a couple questions about the book and a few questions about your thoughts on Star Wars itself. So in your own words, could you describe your book?
Sure. So the idea... really was that there are a lot of collecting guides out there that I've seen for Star Wars, and usually it's for things like action figures and whatnot. There really wasn't any kind of dedicated book specifically for Star Wars home video collectors, because we're kind of a niche thing.
Right. I mean,
most people think collecting, they don't think home video. They think, you know, home video is just you buy it, you watch it, eventually your player is obsolete, that one sits on the shelf, and you buy the next medium to watch it on. But there is a community of collectors out here. And I went to some of the best sort of general Star Wars guidebooks that I've gotten my hands on, things like Jeffrey Todd Carlton's Star Wars Super Collector's Wish Book. And they talk about home video, but it's all like product listings, basically. It's never anything in depth.
Sure.
And by trade, aside from being an author on the side when I'm able, I'm also a teacher, a history teacher, history, economics, and stuff like that. So I'm really interested in the history behind things, not just product listings. So I sort of created this book after what I wanted to see.
Right.
So it's a guide that goes through the history of American Star Wars home video releases. So you've got the films, you've got the cartoon series, the Ewok telemovies are in there, behind the scenes videos and things like that, all sort of divided up into their own chapters, their own little segments and such. But it goes through from a historical perspective, and runs through, you know, why does this exist the way that it does? How did this company change between this release and this release? How did the content change and that sort of thing? So that it winds up being something that if you really wanted to just look at pretty pictures of the products, you could. If you wanted just a checklist of products to help you track them, there's a chapter in the back that's basically just a checklist of everything with product numbers and all. But if you're really interested in the history of it, the evolution of it, you can follow it by reading it as essentially a prose or a narrative history of Star Wars home video. It's just under 300 pages, but it's a very dense book as far as facts go. I would liken it to picking up like a survey of U.S. history type of book where it's illustrated throughout with the pictures, but it is, you know, pages of text to take you through the details and nuance. I wanted something that was literally a history of something rather than just a product guide. So it's one of the more in-depth Star Wars collecting guides as far as narrative and explanation goes that's out there. But it's specifically for U.S. home video with a few little unusual, interesting foreign releases tossed in for good measure when it reflects something interesting about our market.
Sure. I think one of the things is that I've been trying to collect all the editions of the films for years. And it's kind of one of those things, if you weren't collecting when they came out, you're kind of on your own. And I figured that, I mean, after looking at your book, there's not really a lot of places that all of this information is put together with also, you know, like you said, background behind it. And I think that's maybe the greatest thing, that it's not only a collector's book, but also an enthusiast book where you can actually, you know, learn as you go. It's not simply, like you said, it's not a Wikipedia page where it just has every listing and year. Like, there's a lot more to it, and I think that's one of the, you know, most fascinating things about the process in your book in general. But so every item that you have listed, you have a picture of as well. And it's been said that it comes directly from your personal collection. And how long did it take you to collect everything, and when did you start exactly?
Well, I mean, I started – it depends on how you measure it, right? So the first time I actually owned a Star Wars home video item was around 1993. I was in middle school, and I got one of those Lucasfilm Company store catalogs, I guess from a video game or something, probably one of the LucasArts video games, and saw that you could buy – the full screen box set from 92 of the original trilogy. And there was a special letterbox widescreen collector's edition with a hologram on the front and everything. And I basically, you know, saved up money, went to my mom and said, please, 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 can you use this money and put it on your credit card and order sure. these things for me? So I started collecting, I started acquiring them, I guess you'd say, in around 92. But for the longest time, it was basically just, I would pick up the next version of the film. So, you know, I would ignore anything that was sort of a reissue. Like I bought the 1997 special edition VHS release, so I didn't feel a need to get the 2000 one that was basically the same thing as far as the cut of the film that was on there, just with a new behind the scenes feature. You know, I'd buy the complete saga Blu-ray set, but then I'd ignore the trilogy Blu-ray sets that were released alongside it because I saw it as redundant. So for a long time, it was more sort of collecting versions of the film so that I have all the different iterations, you know, special edition, DVD version, Blu-ray, every time George Lucas tinkered with it to have a different version of that tinkering. But it was around probably, I guess, 2013, so about 4 years ago, where I'd been collecting the Star Wars, what's now the Legends continuity books and comics, and made just a massive library of that. And got to a point where, for the most part, the stuff that I wanted for that collection, I had acquired. And it was down to basically just every now and then looking for a signed copy of something, not really looking for anything left on my to-grab list. And the result of that was I was looking for something else to collect. So I shifted a bit and started collecting home video. And I've just been keeping up with new releases since then, and then keeping an eye on places like eBay to pick up the odds and ends items. And it's odd because you enter, get down. Got a cat that is standing on top of a bunch of posters from Celebration over here.
That's all good.
Let me try that again. It's odd because basically, there were things that I didn't know existed at the time, all things that I'm learning about as I go along, in collecting, and it sort of fleshed out the picture for me of what actually is out there. So I actually thought early on that, oh, I've got enough stuff that surely I've got most of it already. And then the CEDs, or and then the VHDs, and then, oh, well, there's all these 8mm reels beyond the, or yeah, 8mm reels beyond the ones that I thought were out there. Oh, here's this book that happens to contain a DVD that eBay's for $1,000 or $2,000, oh God, you know, that
right,
sort of thing.
Sure.
So, I mean, I'd say I'd started really kind of hardcore collecting around 2013, but I had a decent enough starting point that it wasn't trying to get everything to begin with. But you're right, if you're, I mean, if you're looking for this sort of thing, there's really, the sound turned off on this instead of making sounds.
It's all good.
But you're right when it comes to, you know, there's really just not any other kind of guides out there for it. That's why part of the impetus behind writing the book was so that there would be one. So I didn't really have much to go off of as a checklist to find things. And it really did – it helped to have other collectors to talk to. Justin Berger has a great Facebook group that is a good place for discussion about that, to go in and sort of ask questions and such. But beyond that, a lot of it was sort of just trial and error and seeing what exists on places like eBay. Unfortunately, with these things being out of print, in a lot of cases, they'll take one out of print before they put the new one out. I mean, that also meant that a lot of this stuff, not only are you on your own, but you're also looking sometimes at ridiculously high prices for stuff that really probably shouldn't fetch that much. Like in 2008, they did a reissue of the each trilogy in a box set of DVDs, but all it was the exact same discs they'd released before. They just put it in a new package, so it was all together. But because it was so redundant, almost nobody bought the thing. It was very loud. But since they were so redundant, almost nobody actually bought the things, which means that now there's less of them out there on the secondary market. So all of a sudden, the prices are through the roof because of such low supply. I'm like, I could have bought this back then for a third of what people are asking for now. See, it's very much a Wild West collecting for this stuff in a lot of ways.
I mean, yeah, there are things that you would expect to shoot up in price, like the 8mm, the reels that, but and then you can get those for $40-$50 sometimes, and then there are some of these DVD releases that you figure, oh, this is the medium that has sold the most, has had the most copies available, and it's the prices that you like you said, Wild West. You just really never know when it comes to collecting these things. So not only do you not know what all to get, you just never know what pricing you'll find. And that's again why your book kind of brings it all together. And I'm not going to toot your horn too long, but still at the same time, it brings all these factors together, and it kind of just makes it easier for the viewer who wants to become the enthusiast. So, like we had talked about, every item you document, you talk about, the historical context. So it, not only does it relate the history of Star Wars, it talks about the history around the releases. Was there like a certain area that you really enjoyed talking about, or maybe a certain area that you really disliked talking about, just didn't know enough about, more along the historical context?
I would say that probably the more interesting thing would be when we get a chance to go into things that people don't tend to think about as changes to releases. So the earlier eras, for instance. So these days, a lot of people are conversant in things like the Blu-ray releases, the DVD releases, how they compare to the special editions. And most people that I speak to or who are more casual about collecting, if they're about my age, mid to late 30s, probably the first time they ever bought a Star Wars movie was in the late 90s, give or take. But that means that there's a lot of things from before that that people aren't quite as conversant in. Like you ask somebody, hey, how about those CEDs? How about those Laserdiscs and CEDs that time compress the films to make them fit onto a 2-hour medium whenever they're actually 2 hours and a few minutes?
Yeah,
and they're like,
5 minutes, sure.
I'm sorry, what's a CED?
Yeah.
That sort of thing. Getting into the weird stuff is fun, or getting into talking about things that where you almost kind of leave the audience wondering, wait, what's he about to talk about? Because it's such an unknown thing. Like there was a boxed set back when George Lucas got the AFI Lifetime Achievement Award, or Life Achievement, or I guess they don't call it Lifetime, Life Achievement Award, in 2005. And it was basically just a box set in this acrylic container that had the 2004 original trilogy set in it. It had the Indiana Jones set and DVDs of his other films. And they're all just regular retail releases. They just happen to be in this special packaging.
Sure.
And even talking to people that are big home video enthusiasts, most of them had no idea this existed. I didn't really until the time right before I wound up finding a copy of it, because I was like, wait, what? And it's those types of things that get really interesting, because you get a chance to get into the nuances, not just of what is it, but where did this come from? Why is it so unknown? That sort of thing. I love being able to reach the point where I feel like most readers will be reading it and go, oh, and have that lit up moment. Again, I'm a teacher, so, kind of seeing the light go on in people's eyes, that's kind of what drives that. The one that probably was the least of interest, I would say, I kind of felt like slogging through the Clone Wars.
Okay, sure.
Was rough. Not necessarily watching it. I enjoyed the Clone Wars for the most part, especially the latter seasons. But Clone Wars was a very straightforward release process. It's just that there were a ton of releases. So it's a massive chapter. But it's like, and here's the first season on Blu-ray. And then the DVD. And the second season on Blu-ray. And the DVD. And every once in a while, there'd be something weird. Like, they took the Night Sisters episodes, combined them together, showed them in theaters as a film, put that out through iTunes and never put it out on physical media, which is something interesting to get into. Or using the Clone Wars as a way to sort of dive into talking about how widescreen on a 16:9 TV versus widescreen in a more cinematic aspect ratio are different, and how that applied to the way that Clone Wars was presented. Those types of things were where it felt more a little bit more like a slog, because it just didn't feel like there was quite as much to impart. I guess along those lines, the other favorite for me would be talking about 3D, because it's a medium that not everybody necessarily bothers with in their home. And I'm a big proponent of 3D TV or 3D Blu-rays. Although now they're not even making TVs that do 3D anymore. You have to get an old TV or watch it on a PlayStation VR headset. But getting a chance to talk about, here's where 3D came from. Here's the way that the methods work. Here's the different types that you could see. Again, sort of getting into that point where I'm able to sort of deviate off just enough that it becomes sort of not just a talk about the products, but the bigger picture aspects of home video in general. Anything like that just was interesting. But anytime it was just a, here's a description of this specific product, that's when I wasn't quite as interested, which again is why the book is, you know, a history rather than being a product guide, because if it was just a product guide, I'm not sure that even I'd be interested in reading my own stuff.
Sure. Let alone writing it, of course.
Exactly. Exactly.
So I guess one of the things that I wanted to mention, looking at your book, you stop at around Rogue One, correct? Like you document Rogue One in the book.
Right.
Star Wars, you know, is expanding so rapidly now in the film market to where, you know, we're practically getting a movie a year.
Mm-hmm.
Is there an opportunity to do revisions, or do you plan on ever doing another volume? I know with, you know, accomplishing that, this huge task of writing a book, you don't immediately want to think about writing another one. But, I mean, by 2030, we could have 8 or 9 more films, which could open up, you know, the floodgates when it comes to, on video releases.
Well, I've been asked about this a couple of times. In fact, I was asked about it before the book was even done. And what my decision has been is that I'll wait a couple of years, a few years, whatever, until there's enough new content to justify a new edition. And then I'll put out a new edition, kind of like the book Star Wars Year by Year, where they had an edition, and then a couple years later, there was enough content to put out another edition. Then almost a decade later, I guess, was the next one they put out. It just depends on how much content there is that gets added each year.
Sure.
I took it up through Rogue One so that basically it was the absolute most recent of any releases up to that point. Like, there still haven't been any new Star Wars home video releases since the book came out on May 2nd, which was only like a month and a half. But my thought is that every year we're at least going to get another film, maybe two. We're going to get another season of Rebels or whatever the next cartoon series is.
Another TV show, sure.
Forces of Destiny, the new animation thing they just announced. So it kind of just depends on how fast they're producing new things when it would make sense to have a new edition. But I'm actually already sort of looking at what could I expand upon in a new edition. Like, are there other things I wanted to talk about? And in a small number of cases, I've had the opportunity to get my hands on things. Of the very few things, maybe 3 or 4 things in the entire book that don't have pictures, I've managed to get my hands on those things since, so that I'm able to, for the next edition, add pictures of those, like the Dressing a Galaxy limited edition book that has a DVD with it. That's just this massive, massive sort of brick. But I don't know. I mean, there's definitely the potential for another edition. I'm assuming that there will be, unless something happens that somehow derails that process. But I don't know if we're talking 2 years, 3 years, 5 years, 10 years. It just depends on content. Because one thing I don't want to do is dip into what Star Wars Home Video unfortunately constantly does, which is, we'll just reissue the same stuff with only the tiniest little tweak to it and ask you to buy it all over again. I really want to make sure that there's substantial enough content to justify a new edition of it out there.
So what you're implying is you're just going to tweak your original film and say that it just didn't fit your intentional vision?
Yeah, just be like, see, my original vision was that I was going to cover up through the year 2025. It's just that I couldn't do that, you see, because it was only 2017. Exactly. But now, see, time has caught,
computer technology.
It's all about that computer technology. It's all about that those releases that are out there. It's funny because as sad as that is, you know, looking at the way that Lucas has taken that approach, there was another Lucas adage that I sort of took to heart. Lucas has the whole thing about how a special effect without a story is a pretty boring thing.
Sure.
And my drive through this was the whole idea, you know, a product listing or a product description without a history or without a background is a pretty boring thing. So it's kind of one of those things where I'll find the things that Lucas has said that I'm like, yes, that's right. That's the drive. Faster, more intense. And then you know, then you see the other things, you're like, come on, George. No, and he becomes sort of the thing to try to shy away from. He's an interesting study in a polar opposites.
You have to wonder what happened to George between 83 and, like, that 97 era. What was going on? I mean, goes through a divorce. You know, he's running a business. Howard the Duck, all these things happen. But, man, what an interesting – that's another conversation entirely. George is a case study, that's for sure.
Yeah, definitely.
So this is probably the question that most Star Wars fans, like hardcore fans, get the most. But you get a little bit of leeway on being the expert. So when it comes to like official releases, if someone asked you, what should I watch to get the best like viewing experience, what would you suggest?
So if we're talking about the official releases, so nothing official. Like despecialized no editions Army. Or any of those, right. the fan projects out there. And we're talking about on a modern television setup, then despite the fact that some of the changes made to the films make me want to pull my hair out, I would still say the current Blu-ray versions.
Sure.
Because the audio and picture quality is just leaps and bounds beyond anything previous. Right. I do know a lot of people who swear by either the 1995 THX remastered or the 1993 definitive collection laser discs.
Right.
And I've recently acquired a nice laser disc player that's set up in the other room, and it's hooked up to a TV that is an HD television, but is able to zoom in to a 4:3 kind of aspect ratio so that anything that's letterboxed still shows up as widescreen. But I got to say, the picture quality on a modern TV for older material or older media doesn't hold up very well. You really kind of need, if you're going to play something that's an older medium, you need not just an older player, but an older television to watch it on, to be able to get the experience as it was meant to be, not feeling as though there's something lost from it. If you're talking to somebody who's sort of more of the just like which version to watch as opposed to which one's going to give the better picture and sound quality, but which one is going to be the definitive experience, personally, I would still lean towards the original versions because that's what I grew up with. But, you know, every different Star Wars fan, when they come into it, it seems like whatever version is the first one that they see, that's the one they latch onto as that is their version of the film. Kind of like a Doctor Who fan, you know, whichever Doctor is the first one you see
is their Doctor.
Gonna be your Doctor.
Exactly.
And I guess in that sense, I would say something like the Definitive Collection Laserdiscs would be a good way, or because that's THX Remastered. That's where the THX Remastered Edition from 95 came from, was the Laserdiscs a couple years before. The downside being that we really don't have original versions out there. Because in 2006, they put out those DVDs with the bonus discs that were supposedly the unaltered edition.
Right.
And then in 2008, they just repackaged those into a trilogy set. But those were based on the masters from that 1993 Definitive Collection Laserdisc set.
Not
that
the
was,
original cuts yeah, of the
was,
movie.
It was the second time that they had done any kind of remastering to A New Hope, because they had done it also in 1985. It was the first time of remastering for Empire and Jedi. And even then, it wasn't quite just the same as what was on the Laserdiscs, because in order to have the opening crawl with no subtitle, which was something that had never been released for the home before, because right. By the time 1982 and the first VHS and Laserdisc and all came around, they'd already added the subtitle to it. They just grabbed a nice film copy and scanned that in to make that the beginning of A New Hope on that bonus disc. So it's sort of a hybrid in and of itself. So it's kind of one of those things where there's a pure... I don't want to say that there's a purist way to watch so much as there's a purer, a more pure sure. way to watch for those who want to watch the originals. But yeah, to do that requires such an investment in older hardware, unless you already have it sitting around the house, that for most, I think it's those Blu-ray cuts that, despite the frustration sometimes, you know, why is there a rock in front of R2-D2 right. in this shot and all of a sudden it disappears from the other shot? It's still going to be the best picture and sound quality, particularly as we get into the era of bigger and bigger televisions, greater and greater high definition, now ultra HD I only wonder if when they finally do put out 4K versions of the films, if at some point we're going to see more tweaking. But supposedly, according to Kathleen Kennedy, they're not going to tweak the films again. Right. But obviously, that remains to be seen.
Sure. Yeah, I think, you know, one of the things, I grew up with the Faces edition, the 95 VHS set, and it's just, you know, it's insane. Like, you know, you talk about the pure form, or, you know, my form is that VHS set. Mm-hmm. And, you know, I love to collect them. Every time I see a copy out in the wild of those films, I'll grab them. You know, it's really, like, it's kind of nostalgic. But then after maybe 10 minutes sitting in the VCR, I'll immediately switch to the, you know, the Blu-ray edition and turn on the PS4. And, you know, it's kind of one of those things. Like, I love collecting, you know, I have the laser discs and all that, but one of the things is it's still not that highest quality standard. And, you mm-hmm. know, we've all gotten used to, like you said, bigger and better with our, you know, home media. It's like we're sitting in cinemas ourselves. And I think it's interesting to show how it, you know, how it changes the viewer to where you have to become less nostalgic for what you love in order to satisfy your needs of the present, which that's, again, another one of those things that's kind of iffy, but at the same time, it's one of those things that's kind of happened over the years, especially when it comes to Star Wars.
Yeah, it's interesting because if you look at most films that get re-released on, you know, 4K, or they get re-released on Blu-ray after, you know, a previous VHS release or something, usually it's the company rather than the person who made it who's cleaning it up and putting it out as a re-release. Star Wars was just unusual in that Lucas was actively involved each time they were doing some type of enhancement to re-release it, and every time felt the need to change something. So, I mean, you could pick up – I mean, gosh, I've picked up things like old Shakespeare stuff that was black and white that has been put out on Blu-ray. And it's crisp and clear, and yeah, it's still black and white, but it's incredibly crisp and clear. And it's a way of basically picking up a piece of film history to watch. But with Star Wars, in essence, every time is sort of a new updated experience. So it's not like we're watching the piece of history, which is actually one of the frustrating things a while back. In 2010, it was the 75th anniversary of 20th Century Fox.
Right.
And they put out this giant box set that had films from every year that they existed as a company. In fact, even one from the year before the two companies that became 20th Century Fox had even merged together. And it was this great DVD set. Unfortunately, not Blu-ray. It wasn't quite to that level yet. But DVDs of all these great films. And then for A New Hope, they slip in a DVD. But it's the 2004 DVD cut of the film, where it's been changed multiple times already. And it was interesting because if you look through that set, it's like this is all film history until you hit that one release. And then that's kind of film history, but it's revisionist history, basically.
Well, I think the funniest thing about that is Star Wars could be argued as the most important movie of all time. Maybe it's not, maybe it is. And it's just the complete – it's really ridiculous when you think about it. You release a historical set, and then the one film that isn't up to historical standard is maybe the one that absolutely has to be. And mm-hmm. I guess that's just one of those pieces of hypocrisy that we won't ever understand, because I don't even think Lucas or anyone involved really quite understands the predicament.
Yeah, I think that what we're going to see, I mean, right now, I mean, we're not probably going to see reissues of the original films in their original form. If it wasn't going to be for the 40th anniversary, then there's no other better time to do it. Although they, with home video releases, they really haven't cared about anniversaries. I mean, the 30th anniversary in 2007 didn't have a single Star Wars film release. It was the one year from like 2004 to 2008 that didn't see a reissue of the original trilogy. But I got to wonder, even though Kathleen Kennedy is saying they're not going to do that because it would basically mean sort of tweaking it again, but tweaking it backwards and enhancing the picture and all, and how they don't want to do that because those are George's films, they're not going to touch it. You know, given enough time, Lucasfilm will eventually be under new management again. Right. Disney will be under new management again. And once the rights revert back to Disney for the physical home video releases of the films, which would basically, for those who aren't aware, basically A New Hope's physical and really all distribution is tied up with 20th Century Fox forever. Unless they sell those rights, they have those rights forever. So maybe they'll sell those to Disney, hopefully, or make a deal with Disney. But then for episodes 1, 2, 3, 5, and 6, the rights are tied up for physical releases only, which is why Disney could put out digital ones, but physical releases only up through 2020. So once we get past 2020, Disney then has the distribution rights to everything but A New Hope. And once they've got their control and we get maybe a generation or two removed of different leadership who maybe isn't quite as – like they don't have a personal tie to George Lucas. They're right. carrying on the legacy, but they're not people who would feel as though they have a personal obligation to him to keep things in their original form or sure. in their current form, that maybe that's when we'll finally see that type of change. But who knows what format we'll be on by the right. you know, as quickly as formats are changing. But yeah, it's odd. You have such a momentous film, but the only way to watch it's the closest to the original version possible in a lot of ways is to go not just look at a historical film, but look on what is now considered a historical media. I mean, it's sad for me at age 37 to think that Laserdisc, VHS, Betamax, CED back in the day, that those are things that kids today be like, what is that? Like, kids are going to look at the cover of my book that's designed after a VHS tape and be like, what's that supposed to look like?
Yeah, exactly.
But I mean, it is. It's, I mean, we are looking back now at VHS and such the way that, you know, in the 90s, they looked back at Super 8 film sure. reels. And a couple generations from now, we'll be looking back going, Blu-ray, physical media, what's that, perhaps? I don't know. Star Wars is always going to be that weird blip in cinematic history that is so, as you said, it's so historic. It's such an important film. But seeing the film as it was originally seen in theaters is virtually impossible, let alone the fact that there was a mono audio version in theaters.
Right.
That never got a home video release.
Sure.
The only way to see that's on an old 16mm reel if you happen to get one of those from a, you know, a library or a prison or something.
Exactly.
That still had them to sell off.
Thanks for Dolby Digital, though. That's a lifesaver. I guess I could bring this up because I didn't have it written down prior, but I remember Gareth Edwards, because when they put Red Leader and Gold Leader in Rogue One, they had mentioned that, I mean, obviously those aren't their exact lines, or it's not the exact video being transferred into Rogue One, but they had mentioned that they were able to see what he described as a 4K copy of the film. Have you heard about, like, what do you think about that whole situation?
It was reported very widely as, oh my God, it exists in 4K. Right. And of course, everybody's thinking it must be the original version. What we found later, Gareth Edwards did clarify that what he saw was the Blu-ray version, but he did say he saw it in 4K. Which suggested, of course, across the board that, wow, they must be remastering these in 4K to eventually see release, even if it is the Blu-ray version, that they're just, you know, upping the resolution so that we can have it on a UHD, Ultra HD format. But nothing seems to have come of it. So there's a part of me that hopes that it gets out there. Sort of knowing that exists gives me hope that the other films will be done that way and released, or even if it's just A New Hope. To celebrate its anniversary or something gets put out, even if it's, you know, a little bit after the fact, because we're already past the anniversary just now.
Sure.
But I don't know, because Lucasfilm has well, 20th Century Fox Home Entertainment and Lucasfilm, because now they're not quite as closely connected, have an odd relationship with Star Wars releases existing versus actually putting them out.
Right.
Because, I mean, there's a 3D version of The Phantom Menace that was in theaters, and there are 3D versions of Attack of the Clones or Revenge of the Sith that were shown at Star Wars Celebrations.
Yeah.
None of which have ever been released on Blu-ray 3D, though you would think it'd be a license to print money.
Exactly.
So it's kind of one of those, if it exists behind the scenes, even if the public knows about it, that's still not even a guarantee that it'll be out there. So it's sure. kind of one of those things that gives me hope, but at the same time, their track record has me not willing to say, oh, it's coming! It's coming! Oh, the rumors say it's this Christmas. Nope, the rumors sure. say it's next May. Nope, the rumors say it's next Christmas, because it just keeps pushed. The rumor just keeps getting pushed back, right? I'm not willing to believe it's actually going to happen until we hear something firm. It's the Bushism thing, right? You know, fool me once, shame on me.
Yeah.
Fool me twice, fool won't get fooled again.
Exactly.
Whatever.
Yeah, I think since like 2013, it's been like, don't have any expectations, you'll never be disappointed. And I think that, honestly, focus on what you have, like how you can watch it, make the best out of it. And then if it pops up one day, then we'll all be extremely happy. But why get overly excited about it, or why, you know, scream about it, cry about it when there's just really no reason to get too antsy about it? Did you happen to see the Imperial, like, boardroom discussion deleted scene that had the first mention of Sith Lord? This is kind of a random one.
I believe so, yeah. But, yeah, I forget where I saw it. But, yeah, I remember they had a few deleted scenes we had never seen from early footage of A New Hope that were put online. I guess it may be Variety or somebody showing the video. But, yeah.
Yeah, I remember seeing the, you know, the cuts on YouTube. And there were, you know, there was like three of them. I'm not sure if it was I think it was Gold Leader dropping the F-bomb in a deleted scene, which, you know, like, I enjoy that. And that, as well as, you know, hearing Sith Lord for the first, you know, like, knowing that that was actually in the original script is kind of, you know, one of those things that's kind of cool. But it just kind of makes you wonder, you know, we've always been led to believe that 2011 Blu-ray, all the deleted scenes that we can view, that, like, that's it. Those are, like, this is all we have to see. The rest of it is, you know, it's vanished, it's gone. Like, do those, seeing those scenes, does that bring up questions that people should be asking about what other film have we not been able to view just because it's been locked away?
I would say so. I mean, and this is sort of the same thing that happened with the prequels, because with the prequels, we got a ton of deleted scenes on the DVDs. And they're like, oh, well, here comes the Blu-rays. They're going to have deleted scenes. We're like, oh, we're going to see those same deleted scenes in high definition. No, no, it's not any of the same repeated ones. Sure. It's other deleted scenes that weren't on the DVDs. So now we're back to sort of, if you want all the deleted scenes, now you have to own the DVD and the Blu-ray. Yeah, I think something like that sort of leaves me scratching my head a little bit. Plus things like, you hear Gareth Edwards talking about Rogue One, about how, yes, there was this alternate ending that they had and these different scenes that show up that are just in the trailer. But, oh, they were just for the trailer. But even then, you know, seeing that footage in some form would still be an interesting thing, you know, because surely it's beyond just, you know, the split second that's shown in the trailer. You know, if it's a sequence, I mean, maybe even only the special effects So maybe it's only the special effects that were finished for the trailer, but okay. What about the actual raw footage of them, like, running on the beach, carrying the Death Star plans with them and things like that? But at the same time, I'm thinking, well, there's gotta be more stuff out there for us to see. We should see it. There's also sort of the caveat to go with it, which is sort of the step back and go, well, if we're going to be intellectually honest about it, I mean, in theory, there should be tons of unseen stuff for any movie because of alternate cuts, takes they didn't use. So surely there's a ton of it back there. What's going to be the determining factor in what they decide is worthy of showing versus not?
You know? Sure.
Like, if it's just an alternate take of something, is that worth showing? And I think that's where something – What really interests me is to see something like a release of the mono audio version of A New Hope. Because you watch that, and I've got a guy named Puggo. Puggo Jar Jar's Yoda is what he calls himself online, did a scan and a capture of a 16mm copy of A New Hope, and you can watch it. It's got the 8mm, the mono audio with it. And it's interesting because, you know, it's a different voice for Beru. I mean, it's the same actors, but it's a very different portrayal that's less stern. It takes care of it actually changes the context near the end of the film. You've got Luke being attacked by TIE fighters, and Wedge says, you know, I'm on it, Luke, or whatever, and is tracking the TIE fighters. So we know Wedge is coming to the rescue, but Luke says, in every version we're familiar with, just about, says, blasted Biggs, where are you?
Right.
Biggs wasn't coming to his help. Biggs is just his buddy who's out there. And it's like it becomes this moment of him seeing the friendship stretched because, oh, you're here with me. I thought you'd have my back. Where are you now? And then Wedge saves him. Whereas in the mono version, it's got an alternate take where he just says, blasted Wedge, where are you? And it's not, oh, my buddy's deserted me, where is my friend of so many years, and all this emotional weight. It's, hey, you said you were coming to help. Are you here yet? Which is a completely different, you know, and emotional feel to it.
Yeah, that makes a lot more sense in the context of the film with, you know, the Biggs deleted scene in the beginning, obviously not being there, mm-hmm. and then the one, you know, that was re-released with him actually talking to Biggs before, you know, the Battle mm-hmm. of Yavin. It's one of those.
I can remember. I don't remember exactly when it happened, but I know that there was a light bulb moment because I can remember the feeling of it, of having watched the films over and over again in my childhood and onward into teenage and adulthood. And at some point, I think it was when I was in middle school, maybe early high school, that the light bulb went off and I realized, wait a second, the Bigs that he, I guess it would have been like the early 90s. So probably when I first got the home video releases and was watching A New Hope over and over again, the Bigs in the final battle, that's the Bigs he mentions when he says, that's what you said when Bigs and Tank left. Holy crap. It's his friend from childhood, because the scenes didn't exist. The only place you could see them was on the Behind the Magic CD-ROM at the time. And it was just this weird experience to see it. And so it's interesting that sometimes those deleted scenes add that context. Like you were saying with the one of the meeting where they use the term Sith Lord. I mean, the term Sith Lord didn't show up in a Star Wars film until Phantom Menace. And yet Sith Lord has been applied as a name to Vader throughout the life of the saga, not to Palpatine, but to Vader throughout the life of the saga. And it's one of those things where it entered the pop culture consciousness, even though it wasn't in the film. Same thing as, you know, Luke, I am your father. Luke, I am your father is never said, but it entered the pop culture consciousness like that, possibly because one of the adaptations, I forget if it was the comic or the novel, says, no, Luke, I am your father. And that's what people were seeing if they weren't constantly going and seeing the movie over and over again in theaters, because it took 4 friggin' years for it to come out on home video. It's just such a the history of Star Wars and the way that it plays into our perceptions and the way that the home video releases play into that as well, always leave these open-ended questions. I don't think we're ever going to be able to sit down and be satisfied and say, we have the ultimate version of everything. We have everything we want. It's all in one place. It's a perfect presentation. Now they don't have to sell it to me anymore. There's always going to be that, well, maybe we can show you something a little bit extra this time. Sure. Now pay another $100.
I mean, let's be honest. It's a great business tactic that if any of us were in the same position, we'd probably have to do it the same way. Yeah. Is it the right way? That's subjective, but it's the way that probably should be done from a business perspective.
And that's why I have to applaud Disney Home Video, Walt Disney Home Video, as they call it, for what they did with The Force Awakens. People were pissed because there was a release of The Force Awakens in April, and then in November there was another home video release that included the 3D disc, included a commentary, and included more special features on the disc. And yes, it was double dipping within a span of, 7 months?
7, 8 months,
and that is frustrating, and I get that. But at the same time, you look at the new version and it didn't drop a single thing. It added, it didn't drop a single special feature, nothing. In fact, it took the stuff that was originally released as digital only exclusives from Target with a code if you bought their release in April and put them onto the disc for everybody. So yes, it rendered the ones from April pretty much obsolete because exactly the same stuff was on the new release, but it also meant that you could actually just own one version of that film and have everything. And they've never really done that previously. All these different releases of, say, the original trilogy, the different releases all have different special features. You have to own multiple copies to have all the different special features because they just don't turn around and archive that on the next format. You would think that Blu-ray with its storage capacity would have been the time when they would do that. Maybe 4K will be, or Ultra Blu-ray. But until they give us something that pulls it all together at once, it's going to be like that. It's going to be, hey, here's something new, here's something new. And as a business practice, I mean, it keeps Star Wars profitable on home video, whereas most things, you release them, and that's it. There's never another edition of it, so they have to move on to the next big thing. But Star Wars is such a moneymaker, I guess every once in a while you got to bring that back out. If the geese are laying eggs and you're able to sell them every so often, but you've got one that lays golden eggs, probably ought to break that one out every few days, you know?
Sure. Could you see the same thing happening with Rogue One? I mean, I myself, and I know countless other fans, were pretty ticked with the lack of deleted scenes. That seems like a pretty big thing to put on a Blu-ray or a special collection. Can you see within the next year another version coming out with more bonus features, as well as not necessarily a director's cut, but deleted scenes.
If they were to do some kind of alternate cut, maybe. I think it's less likely than it might have been because of 3D Blu-ray being included the first time. Because it seems like, I don't know that they would have been able to justify a reissue so soon of Force Awakens if they hadn't been able to say, well, we promised you that later in the year there'd be a 3D release as well. Now here's your 3D
disc. So might include it. Sure.
So that could be like the big selling point. But maybe if they get to a point where we do see an Ultra HD Blu-ray release of Rogue One, and the big selling point can be, well, it's 4K now. But we've included these extras. And they can kind of do like they did with The Force Awakens, where it's more the format that's getting the big hype, but they're going to slip those extra features on there as extra incentive, perhaps. But that begs that question of, well, you know, which films are we going to see first for Star Wars on UHD in the first place? You know, is it going to be a reissue of previous ones from Lucas's tenure? Is it going to be the Disney tenure ones? I would think Disney, because they got the first crack at Blu-ray 3D. But then I look back and say, yeah, but when they made the jump to Blu-ray, hell, the first Blu-ray was the Clone Wars movie. It wasn't even a live-action film. But hopefully at some point we'll see more of that, or more releases of it online or something, so we can see it. It's a curiosity, but at the same time, I don't know that it's enough to justify a new release. But that then leads to the corollary of, well, if it's not enough to justify a new release, then hopefully someday they'll come up with something that justifies a new release, because I do want to see more special features. I just don't know when they're going to have the opportunity to do it. So it's almost, please double dip. Oh, God, did I just say that? That kind of thing.
Yeah, I mean, eventually we're going to have nine full-length feature films and a couple of spin-off films. Are you expecting a large collection either on 4K, Blu-ray, within the next 5-6 years?
I would think that within a few years we're going to see some type of 4K release, whether it's digital or physical. It's hard to say, but it is sort of the next step. It's really a question of just how widespread the use of an Ultra HD Blu-ray player would become, whether we're talking about an Xbox One S, Xbox One S, or actually buying a multi-hundreds of dollars player just for those, and how much 4K TVs spread out. They've certainly spread out more than 3D televisions, but they're still not the majority of televisions out there. But once you see that type of proliferation, surely we'll see something Star Wars in that format, even if it's just the newer films or the newest next release. As for a big box set, I wonder about that. I would hope that that's possible. I mean, if Sony and Disney can come together for putting Spider-Man in the Marvel Cinematic Universe movie,
sure,
maybe we can get Disney and 20th Century Fox Home Entertainment to come together when it comes to the films. Because even if you tried to do a box set after 2020, when the rights to Lucas's films other than A New Hope revert to Lucasfilm and therefore Disney, you still got the issue of A New Hope being stuck on the 20th Century Fox home video side. They'd have to strike some type of deal to put it out there, kind of like what they did back in 2015. Because in 2015, they put out the digital collection, and every film except A New Hope had the 20th Century Fox fanfare removed, had a new fanfare that was kind of truncated playing over the Lucasfilm logo because 20th Century Fox had nothing to do with the digital distribution of those films. But A New Hope had to still have it on there because it was still technically distributed through 20th Century Fox Home Entertainment. It's why even now you still can't buy A New Hope on Disney Movies anywhere, but you can buy the other films on there. But there was some type of deal that had to have been struck to make that possible. So if they can do that in 2015 for digital, and eventually Disney's position is going to be much stronger logistically because they'll have the rights to distribution of everything but A New Hope.
Right.
Surely a deal can be struck when there's a lot of money to be made. Otherwise, it'd just be odd. I mean, we might see a box set of just the Disney-owned films or a box set of the prequels but not of the original trilogy. But all those would just scream, why don't we have one for the originals? And the broad marketplace out there, the broad vast base of consumers have no idea about distribution rights and who owns what and why A New Hope would be stuck with 20th Century Fox. They'd just be saying, why the heck haven't you put this out? You all suck. And they don't want that kind of publicity to say, you all suck.
Yeah, I find it hard to believe that they get complete total access to distribute, you know, like The Empire Strikes Back and Jedi, and not capitalize on releasing the original trilogy. Now, it's something that they could very easily not do, but I just see, I mean, these movies are still all around cash cows, especially if you could release all three of the prequels and, you know, some of the highest grossing movies of all time. I don't know why you wouldn't do that.
The only reason I would say why they might not do something like that and be able to strike a deal would be taking the example of X-Men, because Fox has the rights to X-Men, and they've been putting out all the different X-Men movies. In fact, there were points at which there was talk of whether or not they needed to put out a new X-Men movie within a certain amount of time, otherwise lose the rights. And what we saw was Disney taking sort of vindictive action, or Marvel, owned by Disney, taking sort of vindictive action against the X-Men comic line and toy lines and such as a way of basically minimizing the exposure of the X-Men anywhere other than Fox's movies. And that seems to have shifted somewhat. But you saw the same type of tactic going on with Fantastic Four to kind of stick it to the company over that. So it'd be interesting to see if we hit a point where Star Wars becomes a sticking point like that. Like maybe it turns around in 20th Century Fox, you know, maybe request to pay to extend out their license for the original films, and Disney says no. And they're like, oh, well then fine, kiss our butts. You're not going to get access to A New Hope. Good luck with your box sets, Disney. But it's one of those things where and as an economics teacher, I love the idea of the way that capitalism and just if you leave it alone, supply and demand tend to sort of work things out.
Sure.
Because, I mean, if you've got – in general, it's the idea that, you know, capitalism will try to, in many ways, it costs you money to be racist or sexist or whatever if you're in a purely capitalist supply and demand society, because you know what? If you won't sell to that person because of who they are, their skin color, their gender, or whatever, the store down the street will.
Someone else will.
And you just lost money. True. So there's sort of that thing of you can punish, you can make bad decisions, but oftentimes bad decisions punish you financially. And if they were to say, oh, well, fine, you're just not going to get to use anything from this film because we own it and then they're costing themselves money. So to an extent, it's a question of how much would they be willing to punish themselves out of spite if something like that were to happen again? And I would hope with Star Wars, as big a money as it would make, that the profit motive would drive them to be like, okay, we may hate you, but God, we need that money, you know?
Sure. What do you think about the Fantastic Four X-Men situation? Do you think that the Fantastic Four will ever go back to Marvel Disney?
I would hope so at some point, but it's one of those things where what it seems to be now is it's coming down to the question of which is better: lose the rights to a franchise that could theoretically make you quite a bit of money by letting it revert back to Disney, or keep putting out movies before the deadlines to make sure that it extends that license, but have the movies be basically critical flops and laughing stocks of the genre. Is it better to make some money and put out stuff that's going to be mocked versus, you know, sort of save the reputation of it and let it revert back? I would almost think that the thing that would be more likely to be seen is that they would do something to still try to hang on to the license and then try to say, okay, well, we might terminate that license early and let the rights go back to Disney if Disney pays us for it, and kind of be like selling the rights back to them, kind of like what 20th Century Fox theoretically could do with A New Hope and sell those rights back to Disney. It's just that in the case of something like Fantastic Four, there's a time limit aspect on it.
Right.
It's kind of like with Empire Strikes Back, for instance. But I mean, even then, you know, it's possible. It's, never, I guess, never underestimate the profit motive side of things and the ability to decide that, you know, just like you could say that the ability to make a lot of profit should override spite and override prejudice and such. You also have the instance of getting a little bit of profit still overrides no profit at all.
Right.
And putting out a crap movie that has a good opening weekend is still going to make you money, even if the movie is garbage.
That's true. Oh, okay. That was a tangent, but it's a good tangent though.
That's all right.
It's a good tangent.
But I mean, it definitely applies because it's one of the rights when it comes to film is becoming something that people who are into sci-fi are becoming more aware of because of what's happening with the Marvel characters. And the more they become versed in that, the more that hopefully people will eventually become versed in the way that the Star Wars rights works. And that'll just be anything that educates the broader audience out there on the way that the home video market and such works and the movie production market works. I think it's a good thing in the long run.
I definitely agree with that, you know, and it goes to show that the more Star Wars fans are educated can get them more to the spot where they, you know, the more people that are demanding something, it kind of goes back to the free market. Usually someone wants to meet those demands. Yep. So if you can educate as many film enthusiasts, as many Star Wars fans, about the possibilities of this home video system and, you know, the films that we can get and the quality that we can get and the original versions that we can get them in, you know, the more people that want them, the more likely we will get them.
I just like it's like you have people saying they're going on freaking change.org, which was designed for petitioning the government things for social issues and whatnot. And people are going on change.org and setting up petitions saying, let's make a petition and say, Disney, release the films in 4K. Release them now. And I'm sitting back saying, they can't.
Yeah.
Disney doesn't have the rights to do that right now.
Sure.
But people don't. I mean, it's just a gut reaction. This is what we want. We're not going to take the time to research what's actually possible. As a teacher, I'm all about the idea of the more educated we are about things, the more intellectually honest discussions than we can have.
Sure.
And the more we can solve things. If you want to do a petition, don't send it to Disney. Send it to 20th Century
exactly.
Fox Home Entertainment. You know, just we got to pick the battles so we're not fighting on every front. But when we pick a battle we're passionate about, we do need to make sure we know who the other side actually, you know, is.
Dear Fox, if you let Disney have the rights to A New Hope, we'll go see X-Men Apocalypse twice.
We'll go see any crap movie.
Yeah, exactly.
Like any crap you want to put out there. You can sell A New Hope in a box set with your worst crap from the last 20 years, and we'll still have people out there buying it
exactly.
like me to get just A New Hope. Just like I bought that 75th anniversary 20th Century Fox set just for A New Hope and paid almost $500 friggin' dollars for Dressing a Galaxy just to get that for its home video.
Man, that's insane, but
That's the most I've ever paid for a home video item ever, and God, I hope it is the most I
ever spent. Sure. I commend you for it, though.
But for a book that usually goes for, you know, upwards of $1,000 to $2,000, it wasn't too bad.
Sure. So like, out of, you know, the items in your collection, that those were the hardest to come by, as well as the most valuable, or just the most valuable?
Those are both, actually. I mean, there's some that are hard to come by, like screeners and things like that are tough to come by because they're produced in such limited quantities just for, you know, people to gauge for awards or for reviews and things like that. Finding some of the things that are hardest to find are the things that you wouldn't have thought people would have kept. Like the original release of the original trilogy together wasn't actually a box set. It wasn't like a slipcase box set kind of thing like we think of those bricks.
Mm-hmm.
It was just the three films with this basically like paper band around it that said Star Wars trilogy and that you're buying them all together and it had a little card with trivia and stuff like that. But most people who would have bought it at the time probably threw the little paper wrap away.
Threw that off and just kept the films, sure.
Right. So it looks like just the individual films that you could have gotten anywhere else. So finding something like that that's intact can be rare. But with the case of those books, it's a double whammy because Sculpting a Galaxy, the limited edition giant box version of that one, they only made 3,000 of them. It's a limited edition signed by Lorne Peterson from the model shop. Has all kinds of replica stuff in it. And then you've got Dressing a Galaxy. That one originally retailed for $395.
Wow.
Dressing a Galaxy, this huge box set, has actual cloth samples from the films. It's got a piece of one of the screen-used Vader capes.
Oh, cool.
And stuff like that in it. But that one originally retailed $295, but they only made 2,500 of them. So it's one of these things where we're over a decade since those were released. They were limited to begin with and expensive to begin with. And you add in the fact that there, especially with Dressing a Galaxy, there is a vibrant Star Wars cosplay community out there. People who do the costuming and they want to know what the actual fabrics and stuff are to make them screen accurate.
Sure.
So, I mean, even put it this way, without the limited edition version, just the regular hardback book copy of Dressing a Galaxy that originally cost $50 tends to go for hundreds of dollars now. This deluxe set with the fabric swaths and everything, you're talking usually, you know, again, 1 to 2,000 most places you could find it. And that's if you can find it. Same thing with Sculpting a Galaxy. You're looking at hundreds. If usually that one doesn't go quite as high, but you're still looking at large price tags, even if you can find it. Like, you can find Dressing a Galaxy on Amazon and on eBay. It's just that they're going to be thousands. Finding Sculpting a Galaxy in its limited edition form anywhere is extremely difficult.
Sure.
But most home video collectors, thank goodness, won't even think to add them to home video collections because it's technically it's a book with extra stuff. It's just the extra stuff includes a DVD. So for someone like me who's a completist, must have. But for most, like, I don't need that for my collection, so I don't need to drop the cash on it. There's I've always said that sort of your focus it's like Qui-Gon, right? Your focus determines your reality. Well, for a home video collector, you know, your focus determines your collection. You yeah. decide what it's going to include. You decide what complete means. I mean, does complete mean one version of every cut of the film? Does complete mean every different release from the U.S.? Does complete mean every worldwide release and you're going to spend money like crazy and probably never manage to pull it off?
Sure.
It's totally up to the individual.
Was there one that maybe, like, took longer to find or something that you had to wait for, watch for?
Oh, yes. Big time, big time. And I'm still looking for one of them, of this. In the U.S., they never released the full runs or anything even close to full runs of Ewoks or Droids, the cartoon series.
Sure.
But in the U.K., back in the late 80s, they released almost a full run of each. They basically put out one season of Droids, one season of Ewoks, or I guess each season of Ewoks, with each of them having three VHS tapes, and then the Great Heap Droid Special got its own VHS tape. But what they wound up having to do basically, why it's not a full set, is that they had one more episode than they could fit on three VHS tapes, and instead of spreading them out, they just took one episode out of each season and didn't provide it. So like Kobe and the Star Hunters is missing from Droids, for instance. But you can still find those every so often from the UK. And I actually found I was looking for them for years. Finally found an eBay auction with all the Ewoks ones in it, except the Dairy Lee cheese spread mail-away VHS of all things, which I was able to find. And it came with one of the Droids ones. And just recently I found two of the other Droids ones that I need. But I'm still looking for one of the Droids VHS releases from the UK. And this is... Yeah, I mean, this was even before I was even really collecting this stuff, I was looking for these. So we're probably almost a decade on of me looking for that one tape, Droids Volume 2, I believe it is, and not being able to find it. It's just, there are some things that just don't hit the market as often. Although I would say and there's actually before the checklist chapter at the end of the book, there's a book on tips for home video collectors. And one of the tips is, you know, keep an eye on eBay, do periodic searches, even if you don't expect to find something. Give it a try. You know, you might be surprised at what you wind up running into. I didn't expect to find a copy of Dressing the Galaxy or Dressing a Galaxy that was less than $500 on eBay. And I didn't expect to find it, even if I did, at a time when I'd be able to afford it from having some extra cash flow coming in. It just happened to have, you know, kind of the perfect storm of events come together all at once for me to be able to pull that off and for them to actually be one on there. You never know what you're going to find. Just do a random search for Star Wars screener, and who knows what you'll find. I might find a Rogue One screener, for all you know. It just depends on luck in a lot of ways.
When it came to, like, the Droids Ewoks set, when they do wind up on the marketplace, is it just because people know what they have, or is there ever instance when people just have no idea, they're just trying to get rid of stuff?
That's a little bit of both. When I did find those, the volume one and volume three of the UK Droids VHS, I was able to get both of them for, gosh, it was a translation of pounds to dollars, but I want to say each of them was like $15 or something like that, 15 to 20, which is nothing compared to what they could go
for. They should or could go, sure.
Right. Whereas, other times you'll have people put stuff up, like the people who have Dressing a Galaxy most of the time know what they've got. And they'll put it up with like a starting price of $1,000 or something like that.
I guess that makes a lot more sense, because usually the people that bought them, since they retailed so high, they already know what they have. But something like a Droids or an Ewoks tape could be like, yeah, right. someone's kid wanted it, or someone just doesn't know what they have.
I think that what the key there, if you're going to try to sell something from a home video collection, is do your research on eBay. Look at what there's, not just what the starting price is for most things, but look at what things are selling for. Look at what the bids are for these. Like, there was a guy like that original set of the three films with the paper band around it, right? I was able to get one for a little over $100 off of eBay at one point. It was in good shape. It had everything in there. It just didn't have the shrink wrap around it anymore. But it took a long time keeping an eye out for that to finally find it. And that person seemed like they kind of knew what they had. They set a higher starting price than they might otherwise have. But still, it was a reasonable price, an affordable price. Whereas there's another person who's had that set, I'm assuming it's probably still up there on eBay right now, who has had that set still in its original shrink wrap sitting on eBay with a buy it now price of something like $1,500. And it hasn't sold, unsurprisingly, right? Because $1,500.
Sure.
You run into the opposite side, which is people who, instead of not knowing what they've got and lowballing the price when they put it up there, they think too highly of what they have and don't look and see how many are already out there and what they're selling for. And they set a price that's so high that it doesn't sell at all.
Right.
And that's when you get into that realm of, well, if there's only one of something out there and the price is set high and you think it's too high, do you still buy it? And for the economics teacher, it says, well, then if you're still going to buy it, it actually wasn't too high for you. It's just on the edge of what you'd be willing to buy,
right?
Isn't it? But yeah, you'll find some things every once in a while. They're a little bit hinky, iffy. And a lot of it comes down to people just needing to also kind of know what's out there. Like, there's a debate actually going on right now where a person is selling the 2006 widescreen DVDs of the original trilogy that were exclusive to Walmart that have comic books packed in with them.
Right.
Well, those tend to go for about $60 to $100 each, and he's asking about $200 for all three, which is not a bad price. But there's a person that popped up and is like, you can go to any store or go on eBay and get those DVDs for like $20 or $30. And I was like, yeah, but you're not getting the fact that the reason why the price is so high is because that's what they usually go for if they're the exclusive still packed in with the comic in that original packaging.
Sure.
Know that there's a difference in those products. What gets me is when people get caught by things that aren't even real. Like in 2011, they put out the Complete Saga Blu-ray set, and they did a reissue of that in 2015 with Vader on the cover.
Right.
There was not a DVD equivalent of that. They just put out a Blu-ray release. But that made it open season for bootleggers to create DVD versions with bootleg DVDs inside and make the package look like that and play it off as if it's a DVD equivalent of that. It's the single most prevalent bootleg of the last decade. And people are still buying it like crazy, not realizing that what they're buying is a bootleg.
Right.
And in some cases, until they even get it and look at it and they think that it's legit still. It's the only bootleg, actually, that in the book I take pains to actually point out and explain why that's not legit. It actually led to the creation of a be aware of what exists and what doesn't in the tips section.
Sure.
So it's a Wild West in a lot of ways. But the more knowledgeable you are about it, whether it's through reading my book or something else or doing your own research online, the more knowledge you come into it with, the more you'll kind of know what prices are relatively worthwhile, and what actually is out there and is the hardest to find, easiest to find, and that sort of thing. Like, people who freak out about screeners, I've seen people be like, oh my God, it's the screener for Ewoks The Haunted Village on VHS. Well, yeah, it's probably the most prevalent screener that's out there. It's still cool, but don't be paying $100+ for that.
Right.
But if you take the time to research, you'll hopefully be able to sort of warn yourself of those types of things.
Yeah, I mean, of course, just the best thing is to be educated. And some guy that I know, he actually wrote a book, and he's got like 300 distinct items in it, and I guess you can buy it. You know, it's called The Saga on Home Video, A Fan's Guide to U.S. Star Wars Home Video Releases. So, I mean, if you pick up that that book, you could probably start your collection.
It sounds fantastic. You know, this video, this is where I'd smile and there'd be like a beep.
Sure. your eyes would light up. But
exactly.
So, like, I guess my final question would be, like, someone is starting their collection. Let's say they don't have your book, which they should. I highly recommend it. But if they say they don't, could you recommend maybe 3 or 4 copies of the films, maybe just the original trilogy? Where should you go first? Like, where do you start, and where are the first couple steps you'd take?
Well, I would say that the first thing is figure out what you want to collect first. Decide, it's not so much specific products as I guess it's sort of be a narrowing down process of questions to ask yourself. Like, do I want to collect the films and the TV series? Do I want to collect the films and TV series and behind-the-scenes stuff? Is it anything with Star Wars on it? Am I going to pick up parodies like the Family Guy stuff and the Robot Chicken stuff? Figure out first what you want your focus to be. You can always, and this is probably the biggest piece of advice that comes out every time because it fits with every piece of advice that's otherwise, you can always change your mind later.
You know, right.
You can always start narrow and then broaden it out, or you could start broad and then narrow it down to just the type of thing you're more interested in collecting. But figure out a specific area you want to collect first. Then figure out what formats you want to collect. Is it going to be that you want all the different formats, even if you don't have a player that can play them, like CED, because CED players aren't around anymore? Or are you going for stuff that you can actually watch now, which would probably limit it to DVD or Blu-ray or digital? Consider whether what you're looking for is different versions of the films, or are you looking for all the different home video releases of them? Because a lot of times it's the same version repackaged with new stuff, or even just repackaged with no new stuff. It's just new packaging that you see. And then I would say if it happens to be that what you're looking for is modern stuff, or if you're looking for stuff that includes modern releases, one of the first good places to start is just to pick up new releases as they come out. Get into the habit of pre-ordering them so you know that you're going to get them. Get into the habit of grabbing whatever you think you're going to collect. So if you think you're eventually going to collect Blu-ray and DVD, all the different versions of something, maybe pre-order both versions of this upcoming season of Rebels, the Blu-ray and the DVD, so you know for sure that you've got them. Beyond that, I would say, depending on your budget, start small. Don't necessarily look for the rarest things that are the most expensive. Start with little things that you can pick up cheaply, like say the 1980s different copies of the films from CBS, Fox, or something, to flesh out that collection. I am a firm believer in one of the things that Dave Ramsey talks about, again, going back to the teaching thing, Dave Ramsey talks about when it comes to budgeting and paying off debt. And what he says is basically that if you've got a lot of different debts you've got to pay, you're in a big financial hole, what you should do is start with the smallest one. And then what'll happen is you'll pay off that first debt and you'll feel the excitement and the satisfaction and the accomplishment of having done that. And that'll act to help motivate you to tackle the next highest debt.
Sure.
And then the next one. And it's a snowball, not just of being able to pay it off and being able to put money towards, you know, the bills. You know, I paid off this one, so now I can pay off this one. But there's something to be said for those little successes. It's why in teaching, you really want to encourage students, you know, this assignment may not have been worth much, but they rocked it. Tell them how awesome they did on it and how proud you are of them for doing so, because that will help inspire them for later. The same thing goes with collecting. Saying, I'm going to pick up all the Blu-rays, which are relatively easy to do right now, or I'm going to start with Rebels, which is relatively easy to get all the releases from right now. That gives you a goal to hit that's relatively easy and somewhat inexpensive compared to other things to collect, but completing that will give you that sense of satisfaction. Ha ha, I've done it.
Sure.
That'll help propel you onto the next thing. Doesn't mean ignore other things necessarily. If you see something that's just too good to pass up, don't pass it up. But sort of use that focus. So I would say, if it were me right now and I wanted to pick up the films, I would probably start with one of each version and then start filling in the gaps with the different releases of each version. And I'd probably start VHS and Blu-ray, actually, at this point.
Okay.
Or VHS, Blu-ray, Laserdisc, because those tend to be the lesser expensive. The DVDs you can still get, but since they're still in use, the price tends to be a little bit higher now that they're out of print. If you're looking for TV shows, I would say start with either get all the Blu-rays or all the DVDs of a particular series, and then maybe move on to the other one. But again, it's less about what's the easiest to find and much more about just build yourself small successes. Define what your collection is. Define what complete means to you. And then once you've done that, find ways to do incremental goals that are going to keep you enthused and excited for this. Because the last thing you want is to spend a year spending a ton of money collecting a bunch of stuff, and then when the year is over, go, you know, I think I'd actually rather collect action figures. And now you've got all this stuff that you're not all that excited about anymore that you're going to have to either sell off or let sit on the shelf.
No, I definitely agree with that. I guess on that note, the final question, like gun to your head, what's the best film in the franchise?
I am... And this is going to make me a pariah amongst some. I'm very partial to The Force Awakens and Rogue One. Probably okay. Rogue One more right now than The Force Awakens, because I love stories of sort of the heroic sacrifice, the Cassian Andor style thing of, you know, good guys who do bad things for the right cause, but it still eats at them, and that sort of nuance to the character. But I've always been someone for whom pacing a lot of times is a big part of film enjoyment. And unfortunately, the way that Lucas made the original films, the original six, a lot of times leaves a big sort of pacing slowdown as we get to the middle of each film as part of the structure of Act Two. And Rogue One and The Force Awakens are done in a different light with, you know, different filmmakers behind it. And the pace tends to be sort of a steady boil throughout. And that tends to be what I'll watch. Like if I pop in one of the Lucas films, a lot of times, if it's not just going to play in the background, I'll usually watch the opening or I'll watch the ending, but I'm not necessarily going to watch the whole thing because of the little bit of drag in the middle. But I can pop in Rogue One or The Force Awakens and just plow through the whole thing and not feel the need to have to get up or stop and finish watching later. So with apologies to Uncle George, so to speak, I actually think right now what Disney's doing or what the filmmakers that they've brought in are doing is what is much more to my taste of, at least in pacing terms.
I mean, that's really interesting. And at least you have decent reasoning behind your choices, although I don't agree 100%. Obviously, it's the most subjective nature of the conversation. But yeah, I mean, that's a good point. I mean, I enjoyed both films. Definitely, they're not my favorites, but I definitely love watching them. I'll give them a watch soon again.
And I guess for me also, it's the fact that, you know, those are the ones that I can watch in 3D. And I do like watching films in 3D at home. I don't have a big 3D TV. I just got that PlayStation branded display that was released years ago. But I can watch 3D at home. And for me, that's the way to watch The Force Awakens or Rogue One at this point. So, you know, take it for what it is. It makes me wonder if they did finally put out the prequels or even the original trilogy on Blu-ray 3D, which is highly doubtful, would that change my viewing experience? It actually probably would.
Interesting. Maybe not about the second, maybe not including the second act part, you know, with slowing down. I don't know how 3D would affect your pacing issues, but I mean, it's interesting.
It's 3D, but it's still slow.
But it's still Luke hovering rocks on Dagobah. I don't know how interesting it's gonna be. It's interesting what, like, viewing the different films in different ways. You know, you feel them, like you see them, and their impact on you always changes. You know, watching the Blu-ray and watching the VHS, you feel two different things, and the movies, they're different entities whenever they're played on different formats. And I think that's one of the greatest parts of, you know, cinema, is that there's just, it's just, you never watch something the same way twice. And it's, you know, it's crazy, but that's how it works.
I think if there's one experience that I am saddened that modern viewers and kids that got into Star Wars with the prequels and such will probably never have, it's when you first go from watching Star Wars film, and all films really, in full screen, 4x3, to seeing it for the first time in widescreen.
Sure.
And having that epiphany moment where it's not, what just happened to the top of the bottom of my screen? And instead becomes, oh my God, there's another third of the picture I've never seen before. And just because I can remember that feeling. And surely at some point, maybe there's yet to be another innovation in film and home video that has had that type of impact. I think 3D comes close, but I'm waiting for that moment for the next generation of what'll be their moment of, wow, I feel like I'm seeing this film I've seen so many times for the first time. See it again for the first time.
Right. Well, I think on that note, I think that we have pretty much wrapped it up. We have been talking for almost an hour and a half now, but it's been a great conversation and have enjoyed every minute of it. And definitely want to thank you for taking your time out of your day to, you know, talk to me and talk to us, the viewers.
No, thank you for having me. It's been a blast. I love talking this stuff with those who are conversant in it, because it lets us go so much deeper a lot of times than otherwise I would. So it's been fantastic.
All right. This has been The Film Historian. Thanks for watching.